Those of you I haven't had a chance to say hello to personally, I'm Jennifer Rabb and have the great privilege of being the president of the extraordinary Hunter College and the home of the wonderful Roosevelt House and the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, run so ably now by Jack Rosenthal and Faye Rosenfeld of Hunter College. We are so excited to have you here tonight. This, I think, was a test. Can you give a program that's really fabulous enough to get people out on a Friday night in New York? And apparently, Ken and Jeff, you reached that fabulous quotient. So we are so extraordinarily happy to have all of you here tonight. We could spend all night talking about the incredible work and passion and brilliance of Jeff Ward as a historian and as Ken Burns as a storyteller and a filmmaker. But every minute we talk about your bio, gentlemen, we'll be taking away from your talking about this film. So I'm just going to really say on behalf of everyone here tonight, thank you for being here, but more importantly for New York, for the country, and really as an educator, to say thank you for what you've done in this particular project to really make the Roosevelts become alive for both the generations who lived with them and knew them, but also for the generations that I now spend our time at Hunter really thinking about, and that's the people who will be leading us into the future. And one of the great themes and wonders and purposes of our Roosevelt House project is to say to this next generation, there were these extraordinary people, the Roosevelts, who believed so much in social justice, who had such a commitment and such a passion, and to ask our students to take a piece of that with them as they go out into the world. And I think for all of us, we know in this world of social media where there's so much competition and so much noise, it's often a challenge to get the younger generation to really focus on things that have come before. And I had a student recently who said to me, wait, Hubert Humphrey was a vice president? I thought he was a stadium. and you realize that, you know, kids hear a name and how do you connect? So we work hard to keep this, the extraordinary history of the Roosevelts alive. And we are, feel just lucky to be blessed with your presence tonight, to be part of your family, to have a tiny little role in the movie, to have Jeff as somewhat of a regular right now at Roosevelt House, and Ken, you may have to fill that slot as well. So thank you for what you've done to keep history alive for all of us and really for the, those of us who will be in charge of this country for the next generation. So it is a pleasure to welcome up an extraordinary, extraordinary filmmaker, Ken Burns.
Thank you, Jennifer. I'll be very, very brief. The first thing I want to say is that Jeff and I tackled this in large part because we find all of the questions that the interplay of these incredibly charged three individuals are so contemporary, that it just speaks to our present moment like nothing before. And it goes to your comments that these people speak to the central questions of our own time, and they do so spectacularly because they are deeply extraordinary people, but also deeply wounded and deeply flawed, and that's we're interested in equally. Now, we worked for many, many years, probably from the time we said go until the time is broadcast, 7 or 8 years. The last thing we want to do is show clips, as was requested, and so I've directed the projectionist to sort of lock the doors, and we'll look at the whole 14 hours. And if we don't do any bathroom breaks, I can guarantee you'll be out at 8:30 tomorrow morning. We are going to show you less than 1/28th of our film. Just four clips, and I just want to very, in 2 seconds, describe them a little bit and then get out of the way and very much look forward to our shared conversation. The first is the introduction of the series, so if it needs an introduction, we are in deep trouble. Having known how successful the film is, we feel confident that I don't need to say anything about the introduction of the film. The second is this is about three Roosevelts, Theodore, Franklin, and Eleanor. And there would be no Franklin and there would be no Eleanor without Theodore. We don't know why the world has, for the most part, segregated these two. Perhaps the superficial idea that he's a Republican and Franklin Eleanor, or at least Franklin, is a Democrat, that we've put them together. And we want, in this series, to understand their connections and not the differences. And so we're going to parachute you down very briefly to our second episode, which is his presidency. The his is a guy that was often referred to as a steam locomotive in trousers, and a very, very complicated person with a lot of undertow, but a spectacular personality that it's important for us to know and appreciate, warts and all. We're then going to jump ahead to our fourth episode, a brief section there. But the thing you have to know is that in 1920, Franklin Roosevelt was the Democratic nominee for a candidate for Vice President of the United States. He and his running mate were defeated mightily by that paragon of Democratic virtue, Warren G. Harding, and his running mate, Calvin Coolidge. It was presumed that Franklin Roosevelt would be, because he had acquitted himself so well in that election, the standard bearer, the presidential nominee of the Democratic Party in 1924. Other things intervened, and we're interested in this third clip and what those other things are. The thing you have to know is that his mother, the very important and not always perpetually a dragon lady, Sarah Delano Roosevelt, took an annual trip to Europe and expected to find Franklin and Eleanor waiting for her at the dock when she got back. The fourth clip, is from the opening of our fifth episode. You should only know two things. One, we've ended the fourth on March 4th, 1933. We begin the fifth episode on March 4th, 1933. And many of the events, starting with our fourth episode and continuing through to the end of the film, have been observed and commented upon by a really important sort of fourth character in this triumvirate, and that is a distant cousin of Franklin, brought in to keep Franklin company during tough times by his mother, named Daisy Sukley. And it's only recently and through the scholarship of Jeff Ward that we've understood not only the extent of the relationship between Daisy Sukley, the friendship between Daisy Sukley and Franklin Roosevelt, but it's given us new dimensions to him, permitted us to triangulate him more from the less one-dimensional than the portrait that we've inherited essentially from Eleanor, that has been obviously reverential and correct and critical, but lacks some intimacies that this extraordinary friendship happened, and she'll be there, and you'll hear from her in that episode, and then we're ready to have a conversation. Thank you very much.
Ken began by saying a few things about the thinking behind putting this documentary together, and I do certainly recommend, if this is all you've seen of it, I suggest you see the others at 13 and a half hours.
Yeah. We can do it tonight.
Right. I really do recommend it. It's really, really engaging and compelling. But could you talk a little bit about just conceptualizing this? I mean, because this obviously is a kind of multi-generational enterprise that you engaged in, and just talk about your thinking as you put it together and thought about putting it together.
Well, Jeff and I have been collaborating for more than 32 years. This is our 33rd year now. And, you know, Jeff wrote in the 1980s two extraordinary biographies of the early life of Franklin Roosevelt, Before the Trumpet, that takes him to his marriage, and then A First-Class Temperament, which is one of the great, great works of biography that I've ever read in my lifetime, that takes Franklin from his honeymoon to his election as governor of New York. And so, as we worked on the various films we've done, we have passed through the time of the Roosevelts, and particularly Franklin Roosevelt, in many different instances. And we always sort of talked about and assumed that we would do something. And I presumed that it would be Franklin alone, Jeff's area of interest. But in point of fact, Jeff came and started talking about the fact that these are three really interconnected people, and they deserved a kind of treatment. James McGregor Burns had done a book, but almost no relation. Almost no one else has sort of put it, as I said in the introduction, together, the three lives together. And I think our sense was, how could you tell a complex, intertwined, interwoven narrative that gives you a sense of what's arguably an American century, 1858 to 1962, of the three enormous actors who were central to the tenor of that age, who nonetheless, as I also suggested, sort of speak to questions that we have today. that it was, you know, we could try to do this. That was it, and we worked for many, many years to try to do it. And I think it's, you know, a real testament to Jeff's voice in this, that we've been able to master a very complex kind of Russian novel of things, certainly three primary characters, but a lot of secondary and tertiary and background noise that goes on, and try to interweave them across those 104 years. It's been one of the most challenging, but also one of the most satisfying collaborations that I think we've had together, certainly in my professional life.
No, I just add that, you know, they used to call miniseries family sagas and family epics. That's what this is. Yeah. It is a great, great family story of people who loved each other and couldn't stand each other, and just like everybody else's family. And it was great fun to do it that way.
I was in a place giving a speech and answering question and answer from the audience, and someone raised their hand and said, Franklin and Eleanor had a complicated marriage. And I said, complicated marriage is redundant.
Yes. That's true.
My wife is in the audience. I won't
then comment. At least we have one person who knows that that's true, right?
You've thrown me off balance here. One of the things I was intrigued by at somewhere in this excerpt that we heard tonight is Jeff talking about these people as the Roosevelts as being wounded people.
Yes.
And who I jotted it down, who needed to overcome things, and they realized it was worthwhile to help people to overcome things. I'd like to hear more about that, and particularly I think about in the context of Eleanor and Theodore. It's a little bit more obvious how FDR was wounded, but maybe not as obvious as one would think.
Let me try for this first, and then I'll give it to you.
As far as those two are concerned, at least initially, Eleanor and Theodore, in what way were they wounded?
Well, first of all, let me just say that in all the time that I've worked with Jeff, who we've written, he's written many, many films, the Civil War, baseball, jazz,
yes.
You know, Thomas Jefferson, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Frank Lloyd Wright, Jack Johnson, The War, Prohibition, I mean, a lot of different films. I have never interviewed Jeff. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting that you brought up that, because we sort of violated one of the kind of walls of this to take someone intimately involved in the production and not only interview them, but have that interview be such a central thing, not just in the introduction, but as you saw,
yes.
In the polio section, hugely, you know, emotionally connective to it. But that's the key talking head in the whole introduction as well.
Mm-hmm.
They're wounded people, and
yes.
I think it's we have to understand it, and of course the their emphasis from Theodore's father on down to even Eleanor's children has been exactly how you translate these things into action for others, which
mm-hmm.
is one great, but not all, American impulse. And that's what this film is essentially about,
mm-hmm.
overcoming fears. So Theodore and Eleanor come from the same family, and she is his niece. He is her uncle. They both suffer from a kind of manic depression in which they have to be completely in motion all the time, or else, as Theodore said, black care sort of comes in over them. And this is a hugely central theme that's with them from the very beginning of their lives to the very end of their
Eleanor
lives.
Eleanor as well.
Eleanor as well, very much so. And Jeff has a wonderful story of corresponding with her. And I can triangulate that story just a little bit if he tells it. But we also understand she's an orphan. There's no reason why she should have survived her childhood intact. And she went on to become, as we say, the most consequential first lady in American history. That kind of transformation, just as the sickly, asthmatic child who was not expected to survive childhood, not expected to live past 30, became the dynamo that Theodore Roosevelt did. But both of them, unlike Franklin, who's, I think, as you suggest, his wounds are very much on the surface for the most part,
yeah.
is a much saner person. He has to be, because he can't outrun his demons once he's hit with infantile paralysis. They stew in him, and there are some things that go on, and I think our series is good at enumerating them, but he's a lot more balanced than the other two, and they vibrate in very interesting, very important, and at times very disturbing ways.
Jeff, did
you? Let me start with the interview that you saw. I wasn't sure I should be interviewed, I went into the interview determined that I was going to be clinical and objective and not emotional.
Huh?
That lasted through the first question. And then he got me. And I'm glad he got me. And I'm very grateful to him for the amount of time that he allowed me to talk about the polio. Because I really do think with this, once you've watched that show, everything else about Roosevelt becomes more extraordinary. Because the gallantry just to get through a day, let alone make a public appearance, is just phenomenal. Yeah. The story that Ken was talking about, Mrs. Roosevelt could not stop working. She stayed up till 2 in the morning because if she went to bed too soon, these ghosts would haunt her, this depression would descend. And I was the strange recipient of that. When I got very interested in Roosevelt when I was 9, after I got polio. And I then read everything there was, or everything that a kid could read. And I decided, for some reason, that FDR probably shouldn't have run for a third term. Why I thought this at the age of 11, I don't know, but I did. And I thought the only way to solve this, because it really bothered me that my hero had made what seemed to me to be a very questionable decision, was to write Mrs. Roosevelt. So I addressed a letter to Eleanor Roosevelt, New York City, put it in the mail, and a week later, I got an answer from her. And I now, and it was a very nice handwritten letter explaining that she wasn't, her husband had not himself been sure whether he should run, but then he saw the war coming and he decided he should run. And you were sincerely Eleanor Roosevelt. I now realize that she probably wrote that at 3 in the morning in order to keep from going to sleep and giving in to those things that haunted her. And it is all the more remarkable that she accomplished what she accomplished, given the stress she was under. She was sometimes suicidal, and she had to be sort of talked out of that.
When was? Did that persist throughout her entire life, or when she was younger?
The only evidence that I know of it is that her last great friend, Dr. David Gurevich, was her physician and her very close friend, used to walk around this neighborhood, actually, with her at night, and she would be so upset by things her children had done, and the gloom that gave her because she thought she'd somehow failed them, that she would say, I sometimes think of killing myself, and then he would talk her out of that. So she's a remarkable person.
The triangulation of that is that I was recently in Texas where one of her grandsons, Tony, lives with his wife, and when he was on his honeymoon, they stayed at her apartment in New York, and she would put the newlyweds to bed, tuck them in, insist that they be there at breakfast at 7 a.m., and then when he woke up in the middle of the night, noticed across the air shaft, the light was on in her office, and she was there writing letters to Jeff, you know? And that's, you know, it's that kind of triangulation. Yeah. I think what we've said over and over again, both of us, is that she's a miracle of the human spirit. Yeah. She's right on absolutely everything, with maybe the exception of prohibition, because her father was a hopeless alcoholic, her brother died of delirium tremens. She was sent off as an orphan to live among abusive alcoholics, and you could understand how you could make that mistake. But all of the issues that we deal with today, in the 21st century, in the second decade of the 21st century, whether it's poverty, race, children, health, yep, immigration, all of those subjects which are at the fore of our political conversation, she was talking about in the 1920s and adamant about what the solution should be. And we've only barely caught up to her vision of things and still have a lot of work to do.
I don't think we'll ever catch up with her vision. Yeah. She's remarkable.
Two questions, one sort of more general. Why is it that she had the attitude she had? From whence did they come? And then I'd like you to talk a little bit about the race question, mm-hmm, particularly Eleanor on race, but also Eleanor and Franklin on the question of race.
Yeah, well, I think
for us, it goes back to Jeff's statement about wounded people. Mm-hmm. At the very end of the film, I don't think it's a spoiler alert, Doris Kearns Goodwin, quoting Hemingway, the subject of a project that Jeff and I are about to undertake, said that we are broken people, but often we are strongest in the broken places. And I think that in the case of the Roosevelts, in every single one of them, they took the lemon and made lemonade. Mm-hmm. And that I think a good deal of that sense of being able to positively affect the others who were so afflicted or like afflicted or had trouble overcoming the hand that life had dealt them mm-hmm. was to serve. And that is the legacy that begins with Theodore Roosevelt Sr., that continues with his son, the extraordinary Theodore Roosevelt, for all his flaws, continues in his niece, and certainly is joined most spectacularly by her husband. Mm. And all of these people have life-threatening, psychology-threatening events in their lives that any one of us might have succumbed to, and they represent three of the greatest figures in our history, and mm-hmm. that's a huge part of it, I think, yeah. is being able to trans. And I would submit that everybody in this room, that often where we are proudest of, or the things we do, are not born of the memory of happy and pleasant things, which are an important part of keeping us going, but are informed by tragedies that happen to us, deaths of others, illnesses. We would not be sitting here, period, if Jeff had not contracted polio as a young boy, period. So he's strong in the broken places.
I'm not sure it was worth it, but I'm glad to be here. you want to talk about race?
Yeah, sure. Let's talk about race. And
That's a big.
And I know you people, the two of you, have dealt with that. It has been central to much of what you have done, Civil War.
It's central to the United States,
right.
And we're interested in the right. United States. We were born under this horrific idea that all men are created equal, except the guy who wrote it thought you could exclude, you know, a huge number of people, including the people who made it possible for him to live the life of a Renaissance man and know the things he did and distill a century of Enlightenment thinking into one sentence. So that's the conundrum right there. Mm-hmm. So we don't go looking for it. Yes. It's just there. If you are uninterested if you're interested in going deeper than a superficial version, one that serves conventional wisdoms about whoever or whatever it is, then you will come into race. You know, and it's here today, you know, and it's here in this city, it's here in Cleveland, it's in Ferguson, Missouri, it is everywhere. There's young black men not alive today that would be alive if their skin color was different than it was.
How did the issue of race inform this particular era that you were looking at? Clearly it did profoundly, and Eleanor played really a remarkable role and was very, very much ahead of her time.
I was going to say, I think Eleanor is the remarkable one. I think Franklin Roosevelt did good things and had basically better attitudes than many people of his time. Mrs. Roosevelt learned everything through experience. She started out with all the attitudes that one would expect of a woman of her class. She hired all black maids because she said you can't have both in the house and they take orders better. That's when she was very young. But she grew, and to me, the most remarkable people are people who grow. Abraham Lincoln grew, Mrs. Roosevelt grew, and she could not bear injustice, and she made very good friends with Mary McLeod Bethune, mm-hmm. who she once explained as a friend of mine that she had never been sure that she thought everyone was really equal until she kissed Mary McLeod Bethune on the cheek. Mary McLeod Bethune was a very distinguished black woman and very dark. And but that's the kind of thinking she simply, she proved things to herself. Mm-hmm. She was not a formally educated person, really. She didn't go to college. And She had to develop all these remarkable attitudes on her own. And then she simply never quit. Right to the end, she was ahead of white politicians, very supportive of the civil rights movement, very impatient with the Kennedys for not sufficiently pushing it. It's a remarkable transformation, and she came so far from her original, her early attitudes toward people.
But, you know, in a kind of patronizing way, but genuine, Theodore Roosevelt dealt with the African-American community through one person, Booker T. Washington, and invited him to the White House and got in a lot of trouble for it and didn't do it again.
Right.
And of course has the lowest point of his career, at least politically, is his treatment of the black soldiers in Brownsville, Texas, who had not done anything. Even a white Texas grand jury had refused to indict because there was zero evidence. He nevertheless fired the whole regiment, and it's just really a despicable stain. But Franklin, I think, to give him some credit along with Eleanor, was perfectly comfortable with everybody, and even people he never met, Jews and blacks particularly, and gave them positions of responsibility in his administration for the first time. And so I think Jeff says very eloquently that as Theodore had sought to address the aspirations such as he could or wanted to of the African-American community through one person, the Roosevelts did it through many. And of course, that is the big title shift, the beginning of the big title shift of African-Americans away from the party of Lincoln towards the Democratic.
Yeah, it happens in 1936. And I mean, Eleanor is, it is actually interesting because that, you know, she is beloved among African-Americans, as is Franklin. And certainly through the mid-30s, not that much, blacks are not benefiting all that much from the New Deal.
Right.
Yet the African-American population falls in love with those who are living in the North,
right.
Anyway.
One of our advisors in the film was a great scholar and essayist, Gerald Early.
Yeah.
We've interviewed him in many films, and he's been a hugely important part. And he related at the end of a screening once that in the 60s, his mother and her friends were sitting around talking about and lauding Eleanor Roosevelt, and he had his dashiki on and his afro hair, and he was just poo-pooing them and kind of like they're hopelessly anachronistic. And he was beginning, as he was relating this, to break up, and he said, "I now understand what my mother was talking about."
Yeah. You mentioned TR, so why don't we talk a little bit about Theodore Roosevelt, and I think he comes across as just in this little clip here, as the dynamo.
It's just a taste of him here.
Was it David McCullough who called him a gas bag?
Yeah.
I think, right?
Yeah.
And I wonder, one of the things I've always felt, I mean, clearly Theodore Roosevelt was an American nationalist. He was also someone who I think had a, how can we describe it, an excessive attachment to war, maybe even a love of war. And so could you speak a little bit about that? Because one thing that I've always found poignant, and I think it comes out in the full documentary, is here was this man who throughout his adult life really was drawn to war, fought rather gallantly in perhaps not the most gallant of causes. He fought gallantly in the Spanish-American War, but at the end of his life suffered he was victimized by war when his son was killed in the First World War and was profoundly, understandably depressed by it. So this man who had advocated war throughout his whole life, at the end of his life, in a sense, got to experience firsthand the cost of war. And I've always found that rather poignant.
It's so complicated that almost half of what you said in your question has to have asterisks. Yeah. Certainly one next to the word gallantly. Certainly one, you know, felt the cost of war because he'd pushed that son and all the other sons as close to combat as possible. So I think part of his reaction is not sort of a reality of war yet, but the painful sense of guilt that he's responsible for the death of his children, and he had tasted war and understood its cost and reveled in its gore.
Yeah.
And as a big game hunter, you know, he bagged himself a human being in Kettle Hill in Cuba.
Having said all that, no gun was fired during the course of his presidency. He was very proud of that, too. So he's a very complicated an absolutely fascinating man. And it's very easy to make a caricature of him. I mean, you saw him being, I mean, he's irresistible. But I hope if you see the whole film, you won't feel that he's a silly person. He's an extraordinarily substantive person. And he set up in the other Roosevelts the sense that, as he said, government is us, you and me, which nobody had ever said before.
No, he was an intellectual.
He was absolutely extraordinary.
Yeah, he read a book a day. I'm not sure.
Well, he said,
and he read with such fervor, just by the way, you saw him reading in the doorway of that little cabin. He read with such fervor that if you've been to Sagamore Hill, there's a great piazza on the front. And he used to sit out there in the summer in a rocking chair and read. And he rocked so vehemently that his wife would sit in a chair nearby to make sure that he didn't spill over and fall onto the lawn. I mean, it's that kind of fervor that he had in everything he did.
And, you know, I just wanted to say that, you know, it is amazing, these two men particularly, what they expended is just remarkable. If you think of the oldest image you have of TR, looks like he's 85 years old.
Yeah.
I'm 61. He died at age 60.
Yeah,
Franklin Roosevelt, who, when he died, the station master at Warm Springs, when he arrived there just the week or so before he died, said that he'd never seen a worse-looking man that wasn't a corpse. He looks to us like 95 or 100. He was 63.
Yes,
I'm 74.
You know, it's an extraordinary thing. A lot of it, particularly with Theodore, has to do with all of these inner battles and the sense of being spent. Obviously, eating a dozen eggs for breakfast each day.
I thought that might have been part of it.
Doesn't lengthen your life, I presume. But it's absolutely right. We tend to have a kind of conventional wisdom about things and people, and we stick to them. And it is incredibly limiting. You know, the trope that follows Franklin around about Jewish, Jewish immigration is one of these tropes that nobody will investigate and understand what you can do in 2 seconds online and understand the more dimensions. Or something like the warmonger, or, you know,
About Theodore,
or whatever it might be. And I think what we tried to do from the beginning was show that it was possible to paint hugely complex portraits of people where it is impossible to default to some facile judgment of good and bad, that they are like everybody we know intimately, which is why this is called an intimate history, not a tabloid history. The people we know intimately are hugely contradictory and hugely complicated, and that's what we wanted to honor. So it's really impossible just to dismiss somebody out of hand or to laud them unnecessarily as one thing when they're quite often, in the case of these three people, more than one thing.
Could you say something about one of the things I've always found fascinating about Theodore Roosevelt is his relationship to the land. Now, here's this man who is, you know, in many ways, I don't know, a quintessential New Yorker. He's very urbane, sophisticated, reading a book a day, three if he has some time on his hands. I don't know, would we ever elect anyone who could read a book a day now?
Well, he's a real speed reader. I mean, he didn't have an Evelyn Wood course, but he had the scholar Clay Jenkinson remind us, and it's sort of, you know, it was sort of almost there in the film. There is he really had figured out a way with his. I believe he's a genius. I mean, who knows?
I think
we've only had one president who is a genius, in what we consider the normal stuff of genius, for good and for ill. And that is Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt.
Woodrow Wilson thought he was a genius.
Yeah. Well, I can tell you that every single one of them thought they were geniuses. I think that Theodore Roosevelt actually was. Mm. And in a way that Thomas Jefferson isn't, in the way that Franklin Roosevelt, in a way that Abraham Lincoln aren't. And that's for good and for ill, as we know.
Yes.
It comes with some pernicious balls and chains.
Yes. The land, would you want to say something about the land and his thinking about the land and the West and all that?
It started with his health again. He was terribly frail as a child. Mm-hmm. He heard his parents talking about, saying that he was not likely to live. He rebuilt his body at his father's urging by going into the woods, and then he was encouraged to hunt. As soon as he got glasses, they gave him his first gun. He couldn't hit a tree, and they gave him glasses, and suddenly he could see. And the outdoors became the place that he could be himself, I think. And then when his first wife and his mother died on the same day, he fled out west, and he found solace in that wilderness. He loved to hunt. He loved to shoot things.
Yes.
It's easy now to look at that as bloodthirsty, and he was not modest in his shooting, but it was how people who were interested in science in those days acted. I mean, everybody, Audubon shot everything he painted, for instance. He came to see the natural world as a pure and exciting and invigorating place, and he never got over it, I think. Mm-hmm. And then there was the responsibility to take care of us for all of us, or take care of it for all of us, and Franklin Roosevelt inherited all of that.
Did you want to add something?
Or? Well, no, I think that's right. When I reference black hair, it's the most famous quote of Theodore Roosevelt's, besides, I guess, the In the Arena quote, which is that, you know, black hair rarely sits behind a rider whose pace is fast enough, which is a 19th century way of saying you can outrun your demons, which he spent his entire life doing. The demons of this frailty, the demons of this extraordinary loss of wife and mother on the same day in the same house. All of the manicness of his life is just a sense that if you go fast enough, and our great, beautiful continent provided it. And then, once again, as we talked before, that when you're wounded, what did they all do? They translated that into things that helped them, and then they didn't see why you couldn't extend that to everybody else, which is this great, extraordinary impulse, and doubled the number of national parks and created wildlife reserves and used the Antiquities Act, which Congress delivered to him, the greatest gift any president has ever had. And as Jeff said, and we forget, Franklin is equally as minded. He takes all of these battle sites and all of these other areas that are in, you know, owned by different things, the Army, the Navy, whatever. He takes them away from them and puts them in interior. So all of a sudden, our national park impulse isn't just saving places of great natural beauty, but places of our history, and not just, to the ever-loving credit of this country, not just things that reflect on us positively, but also things that reflect on us negatively, you know, and that ultimately that park system includes all of us, from slave cabins to signs of massacres of unarmed Indian women and children at Sand Creek and Ouachita on the Great Plains, to Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas, which is still a working inner city high school, is a National Park Service site that has visitors every day. This is a legacy of both Theodore and Franklin Roosevelt. It's a spectacular, you know, if you think about the world we live in today, as George, even George Will would admit,
grudgingly,
it was written by Theodore and Franklin Roosevelt.
Before we turn to the audience for some questions, I think we began by talking about marriage. Seems like a good, I want to come back to that for a moment, but really talk a little bit about the rather extraordinary relationship between Eleanor and Franklin. And I took a couple of these quotes from your book, which there will be a book signing afterwards, so you may find this intriguing. And this is Eleanor reflecting, I think, almost immediately after FDR's death. And she says the following. She's talking about her feelings. And she says that her feelings remained almost, I'm quoting now, almost impersonal. Perhaps because much further back, I had had to face certain difficulties until I decided to accept the fact that a man must be what he is. Life must be lived as it is. And you cannot live at all if you do not learn to adapt yourself to your life as it happens to be.
Now you've got the best quote in the whole film.
Well, I'm glad. They had an interesting relationship.
They had a very complicated relationship.
Then yeah. I'll just quote Daisy Sukley on the two of them. And I think, again, this was right after FDR's funeral, right in April of 1945. And she said, poor ER, poor Eleanor. I believe she loved him more deeply than she knows herself, and his feeling for her was deep and lasting. The fact that they could not relax together or play together is the tragedy of their joint lives, for I believe from everything that I have seen of them that they had everything else in common, It was a matter of personalities. I cannot blame either of them.
I think that's the best quote. She was brilliant about them. Yeah. Just brilliant.
She got them.
Yeah. It was a very complicated relationship. You know, it's 14 hours, or 7 or 8 of those hours are about that. They were not very, you would not have thought that they would be very well suited. She was someone who wanted a confidant, somebody who could would listen to her and love her constantly and unquestioningly. And he wasn't going to be anybody's confidant. And he wanted someone who was going to admire him constantly, as his mother had. And that was not going to happen. Mrs. Roosevelt had very firm views. And then he had an affair, or a relationship at least, with her social secretary during the First World War, something for which she never forgave him. And that's the events in the past that she refers to very vaguely there.
In fact, she found the letters, didn't she? Isn't that what happened?
She found some letters. We don't know what was in the letters. The point is that
they went up in smoke in the fireplace in this house.
Yeah, they weren't supposed to be writing to each other. They led really very separate lives a lot of the time. They didn't really live together most of the time. And yet they had enormous respect for each other. Each wanted the other's approval. And they loved one another. I don't think there's any question of that. So it is very complicated.
I love this relationship because they worked on it. You know, I mean, if you think that the polio section, the brief part of the polio section, that in almost the entire episode is taken up with polio, which is something most people don't do. I mean, they say he got infantile paralysis. Oops, now he's president of the United States. It is a miracle that of that journey in the wilderness with that. But if you think about her dedication to him during this time, it's still within, you know, a few years of the betrayal, betrayal that Jeff quite correctly said she never got over. And as he says, Jeff himself says in the film, that it was a badge of your intimacy with Mrs. Roosevelt if she took you aside and detailed the betrayal. That meant that you were within an inner circle with her, that nonetheless they found a way to become who they are. And I think it is so easy for us to default to the speculation about sexuality on her part, mm-hmm. The speculation about affairs and a kind of harem that the execrable movie Hyde Park on the Hudson seemed to promote. You know, I believe probably he had a sexual relationship with Lucy Mercer, but we actually don't have anyone else. They're both dead, and we don't have anybody who did that. But all the other people were part of that admiring coterie. It was not a sexual harem, as people want to believe, Eleanor was in love with many people, some of whom were women who were committed to other women, and she was in love with a series of other men. Deep, deep, deep friendships that don't necessarily bespeak an affair in that regard. So I think there's just, the truth is probably disappointing for a tabloid, but much more interesting to anybody who has a brain in their head.
Yes. Nicely put. That's well put. All right, I think we should turn to some questions now from the audience, and you can ask questions of these two gentlemen.
There's a mic they should go to, I think.
We'll bring you a mic.
Yeah.
So just choose some people and ask some questions.
Was there anything that Theodore did as president that Franklin thought was wrong? And if you can imagine it the other way, do you think that Franklin did anything that Theodore would have found fault with?
When Franklin was at college at Harvard, and he was sort of mirroring the views of the much more conservative classmates, that when Theodore settled the coal strike the way he did in a very top-down way that seemed extra constitutional to conservatives, Franklin sort of went along with that for a while, but he certainly never forgot that example and did that stuff all the time as president. I think that was just I think they represent two ends of the same equation.
I do too. I don't think there's any, I know of nothing that he disapproved of. He said Theodore Roosevelt was the greatest man I ever knew, and he said that all the way through his life. The other way around, it's very hard. If you belong to the Oyster Bay clan, sure, the whole New Deal was a mistake. But an awful lot of the New Deal was based on the progressive platform and people who had supported TR in 1912. So I think they're wrong. I hope there are none of them here that will give me trouble. But
most of the progressives are no longer with us. Well, from the early 20th
century. Yeah, but all of those conservative Oyster Bay are still around.
Yeah. Why don't we just choose some people and...
Thank you. What a wonderful discussion. Thank you very much. If by some miracle a person of the brilliance of the three Roosevelts existed today, would the political climate that exists today and the dissemination of information that exists today allow that brilliance to come through?
They would become filmmakers.
I think we live in a media culture that selects for something different. And that I suggest that if there aren't leaders of their caliber, because people like this come along very infrequently, that we are populated with lots of heroes. We just have a wrong definition of heroism right now, do we not? We presume in a media culture that's saturating, but there's nothing on. You can't actually get news. You can only get people opining about what they think is happening without having read the thing or actually seen the movie or, you know, whatever it is. And we presume that heroes are perfect. And that's not what the definition of heroism is. And, you know, the Greeks told us thousands of years ago that it was the negotiation between a person's obvious strengths and their equal and obvious weaknesses that defines heroism. Achilles had his heel and his hubris, and it's that thing. And as we point out in the film, all of these people have that. We just live in a culture that doesn't select. There are heroes all around us. They're not an opportunity to be given voice. And all, not all, because we had a different media culture, a different reporting, and as we know from Heisenberg, that the thing itself is altered by the act of observation, all of that vitriol. I mean, if you look at sort of what's said about this president, is not very dissimilar to what was said about Franklin Roosevelt. It's a little worse because of the color of his skin, but it's very, very common. And then I can take you back to the election of 1800 and tell you why that's the worst moment of partisanship. And we barely were out of the starting blocks. So I think we've got to have a sense of, we've got to disenthrall ourselves, as Abraham Lincoln would say, from the idea of a kind of noble, better past, and understand that they're in all of the muck that we're in today. And then also relieve the present of this great burden that it can't possibly equal what's going on then. It's just a question of selection. It's a question of looking.
Just to be very specific in your, I think Theodore Roosevelt was far too hot for television and would never have made it. And I think Franklin, sadly, I think no one as handicapped as Franklin Roosevelt was could ever be elected president of the United States now. There was a gentleman's agreement in the 30s and 40s that you did not dwell on his handicap. Nowadays, Fox News and CNN and everybody else would compete to see who could get the footage that showed him at his most helpless, being carried in and out of a building, being helped out of a car, being helped to stand, being unable to sit down without help. And I just think people, it would become, that would become the subject rather than the substance.
And you know,
it's very sad.
It's very sad, and what's interesting is we then presume that that was a simpler, more naive time, and it's not. Those guys in the press who went along with this so-called gentleman's agreement had 993 press conferences. They saw him every day. Just because they didn't click their camera or roll their movie cameras doesn't mean they didn't see how hard it was. They didn't see the sweat. They didn't see the arduousness about it. They probably knew him a hell of a lot better than we know than the current crop know any president of the last 40 or 50 years.
That's true.
you know, certainly since Watergate. And so we think we gain something from more openness, and more often than not you do. But in many cases, it doesn't do us anything but undercut the very, I think, very real and well-articulated lament in your original question.
Maybe one more question. How are we doing for time? Two more questions?
Three more. Do I hear three more questions?
This gentleman over here.
Well, Theodore Roosevelt was Franklin Roosevelt's hero.
Yes, when he, but I mean, on a personal level.
They knew, you know, FDR visited the White House several times when Theodore was in the White House. He married his favorite niece.
And he gave her, and T.R. gave her away.
Yeah, yeah. And before FDR decided to run for state office and begin his political career as a Democrat, he went to see Theodore Roosevelt to get his blessing, because it was so odd that a Roosevelt should be running as a Democrat. And Theodore Roosevelt said, I can count on you to fight the bosses in either party. And so FDR then went off and did it. And he said, T.R. wrote Sarah Delano Roosevelt once and said, I like that boy so much, I'd be shot for him. So.
And also, when T.R. was sued as the ex-president for libel by the New York bosses, they had a trial in Syracuse, and a lot of the political friends of the president sort of shied away from sort of getting entangled in it, and Franklin very boldly went and testified in support to prove that a statement that Theodore had made about the bosses being the same in both parties was actually true, that that had been his experience, and T.R. was acquitted. And the only photograph, for some reason, of them together intimately, we've got pictures of T.R. being inaugurated and Franklin Roosevelt paying rapt attention to that inauguration, saying, I think I'd like that four times. is them walking out of the courthouse after successfully prosecuting the trial. So they're joined at the hip, first of all, in this adulation that Franklin has for him. He's a very brave man. He's a very heroic man. He's a kinsman. They know each other, and they grow to have, and I think polio has a lot to do with it, this similar, extraordinary sense of trying to help other people.
I think there's one other thing. Theodore Roosevelt represented to someone of Franklin Roosevelt's class that you could succeed in the wider world. I know that seems funny, but Franklin Roosevelt's boyhood was unbelievably cosseted and glossy and limited. And to decide to go into politics and get to know all kinds of other people, Theodore Roosevelt had showed you could do that even though you had that same background. So in that sense, he was very, very important to him, I think.
You know, I just, in passing, I had dinner at a party and William Bratton, the commissioner, the police commissioner, was there. And he said very nice things about the series, but he said, you know, I go to work every day at his desk.
Yeah, that's right.
Because T.R. was one of the police commissioners of the time.
Any other questions? There's a gentleman here in the front.
Yes, sir.
Why didn't T.R. run again in 1912? And if he had,
he did.
You thought about how it would have affected the course of history.
He did run again in 1912. He ran on, So he chose not to run for a second full term of his own. He succeeded the assassinated William McKinley, served out the majority of his term, won re-election handily in 1904, and made a declaration that he would not seek another term, which everyone assumed that he would. He regretted it immediately, installed his very dear friend William Howard Taft, then didn't like being out of power, and tried to run and sort of convince himself that Taft had betrayed a progressive agenda, which in some way he betrayed Theodore Roosevelt's idea of what the progressive agenda should be, and Taft was not as bad as Roosevelt painted him. He ran against him in the Republican parties. It was clear that the bosses would deny him that, even though he won some primaries. He switched to the Progressive Party candidate, also known as the Bull Moose, because a reporter asked him how he felt, and he said he felt as strong as a bull moose. And he came in second, Taft a distant third, but by so running on a third party, delivered the presidency to the first Democrat since Grover Cleveland, Woodrow Wilson, and the rest is history. So he did run again, and had always held out the hope that in 16, that the party would call on him, and that even on the eve of his death,
1920,
he was certain that the party would call upon him in 1920.
Yep.
A final question. So a woman over there.
Okay. Hello. You were both talking about telling the story in two different mediums, right? We have a book and a documentary series, and I was wondering what telling the story on film does that you can't do in a book, and what does telling the story in a book do that you can't do in a film?
Goodness. They're very different. I've written a lot of scripts now, thanks to Mr. Burns, and the pictures are your topic sentence, if you can think of it that way. Ken is wonderful in that he really believes in words. Let me tell you, this is a rarity among filmmakers. And he lets me maunder on, and somehow we make it work. Books give you, you can do a lot more in a book in the sense of inclusiveness, but there are things you, in a book, I mean, I've done 17 books, you can't, that you, and I've worked and worked and worked. Well, I'll give you a best example. What I was trained as a painter. And so when I write and I do history, I sort of see it all in my mind. I have a sort of pictorial mind. I love old pictures and so on. And one of the joys of this thing was, I wrote those books quite a while ago. And to see this stuff actually come alive on the screen was thrilling for me. I mean, it really looked the way I thought it did. And they work together. I don't think I write very differently. It's really the same.
We filmmakers impose a little bit of restraints on Jeff's writing. Things get changed a little bit because when something spoken is a little bit different than how it's read.
Right.
And so there are adjustments there. And inevitably, what a film is a distillation of writing. And so the cutting room floor is filled not with bad stuff, but with stuff that didn't fit. If you saw the movie Amadeus, the great moment when he says, too many notes. That is very much what we're talking about. But there is, and therefore the books represent an opportunity for Jeff to go back and sort of reclaim and reshape and add back the weight and the heft that the process of editing does. But, the picture, as the cliche said, is worth 1,000 words, and maybe it's been devalued today, but we try to give back the full value. We were stunned. We had assembled for our film, both on camera and off, in terms of our advisors, 1,350 years of postgraduate experience in one or more of the Roosevelts or adjacent presidential administrations. We had people who had spent 65, almost 70 years of their professional life in the academy studying American history, Franklin Roosevelt, the New Deal, and that's just one guy. And almost to a person among our advisors, there was this sense at the end of the last screening we had from them, when the film was pretty close to done, that they had finally kind of completed a picture of who these people were, and they finally understood them. There was great emotion, and the film is, I think, emotional, but they were saying that something happened. We happened to benefit from the voice of the late Ed Herman, who passed away just a few weeks ago, as the voice of TR, and we had Paul Giamatti, of FDR, we had Paul Giamatti as TR, and Meryl Streep did Eleanor, and there were many times during the screenings when the scholars, familiar with these words of Eleanor's as type, cold type, I would suggest, on the page actually were moved to tears or gasped when they suddenly realized this was not Eleanor, but someone resurrecting her. And it was a very, very powerful moment. And it reminded me again, both not just visually, but orally, because this is what I want to stress. You are not just seeing words, you are hearing words. You're not just seeing the pictures, you are hearing words being spoken. And that's a magnificent stuff. I don't think that quote that you saw today about the spur, where the spurring always wasn't welcome, is a wonderful interplay between narration and first person voice, delivered by the greatest actor of our generation, yes. And that really helps.
Yeah. Can I just say one thing?
Go ahead.
One of the great moments of my life, I don't know if anyone here knows Alan Brinkley, the really great 20th century historian, and he is not a man easily moved. I mean, he's a very tough cookie. I'm very fond of him. And he, at the end of the 14 hours, he leaned over and he had tears in his eyes. And he said, I've been teaching these people for 30 years, and you made me love them. And now, that doesn't mean we romanticized them. It meant he felt he was closer to them. And that was a great moment in my life. I almost quit.
Well, I would just like to, that's a wonderful story. I'd like to thank the two of you for coming here and doing this for us. And I think it reminds... The work that you do reminds us that history can be both captivating and at the same time consequential. And I'm particularly taken, and Ken mentioned this at the outset, that the work that the two of you have done over the years shows us how important history can be both in helping us to understand the past, of course, self-evidently, and at the same time, I think it can help us to orient the present, and that is quite important, and I think your work does that.